This is always an exciting moment when we start the Facebook Live. I like live events. As you know, I'm a live concert guy. So, you know, when I'm backstage and they say, you know, okay, lights are on in 30 seconds or whatever, there's a sense of excitement and the adrenaline begins to flow. And then somebody says, Ken Medema, or the audience begins to clap or whatever. And suddenly I'm ready to go. And there's a level of, if you're a performing artist, you know this, there's a level of excitement, adrenaline flow that only happens at that last minute. The lights go on, or the people start clapping, or you get the cue. It's time now. It's do or die. And I love that moment. So Sonia always counts me down. Okay, we're going to start in 15 or 14, 13, whatever. And then she says, we're live. Some thank yous before we start. Of course, always, thank you to Sonia, who is so graciously doing all the video. And we've been doing recordings all afternoon here for several hours. Thanks to Jane for being my partner, teacher, friend, scholar, thinker, idea person, good food sharer, and all kinds of wonderful things that have bound us together for 55 years. Thanks to Amy Vreeman down in LA, who actually guided me through using this Zoom recorder we have over here as an external microphone, which has improved our sound considerably. So that was a great gift to us. Thank you for those of you who wrote stories and sent them in. We have a treasure trove of stories for which I am grateful, and I get to make songs out of some of those stories. So there we are. That's how we will begin. I hope you are ready. I think I am. Sonia, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, let's see what we can do. Place to laugh, place to cry, a place to run, a place to fly, a place to leap, a place to learn, a place to discover, a place to turn. Places, so many places. Concert number two. Is there a place for dreaming in the corner of your mind, in a world where dreams are broken down and dreamers hard to find? And do you dream? Only
to daydream a whole lot. And they told me that it would not last. They said I wouldn't have time for such a waste of a good mind when my life really started moving fast. Now that I'm grown, I find that life with no dream is a hell that I simply refuse to bear. So if it's all right, I got to open my mind and see if my dreams are still there. My dreams are still there. Is there a place for dreaming in the corners of your mind? In a world where dreams are broken down and dreamers hard to find, about the way that things should be. Come dreaming with me, dreaming with me. Admission
Okay, I think we got to get right down to stories, my friends, because we have so many of them. Sonia, would you please read our first story of the day?
Yes. Hello, everyone. Okay, this story comes from Linda Davis, and she said, at the beginning of my sophomore year in college, my choir went on a concert tour of Europe. We performed in cathedrals across 5 countries, but the most special place was that of an impromptu, unofficial performance. On our itinerary was a trip into East Germany, though we had no performances scheduled there. Being 1973, it was primarily closed to Westerners, but somehow our tour company had managed to schedule a visit. At the Berlin Wall, we stared out our bus windows at towers with armed guards and high fences with razor wire. We had to get off our buses and hand over our passports. The film from our cameras was confiscated. This experience was scary and intimidating, but worth it when we arrived in Leipzig and stepped into Bach's church. Much of Bach's music was first heard in this church as he spent many years composing there. Tourists were restricted to the lower levels of the cathedral, but they allowed our choir access to the choir loft where we stood in front of the organ Bach had once played, and we sang. Bach's music is beautiful anytime, anywhere, but it is gorgeous with the cathedral acoustics it was composed for. Other visitors to the church froze and looked up at the choir loft in wonder. The sense of history and hundreds of years of worship, even though communism had closed the church for its intended use, was evident as we sang. To top it off, the next morning we learned 3 people had successfully escaped East Berlin into West Berlin that day.
And of course, the irony of this one is Bach is my favorite of all composers. So,
I
barriers. Go ahead and capture your slaves. Go ahead and build your prisons. Grace will find a way. Grace will tunnel through. Grace will keep on knocking and pounding and knocking and pounding until could have known there would be this great dividing wall to keep brothers and sisters away from each other, to divide us, father and mother. But the wall comes down, and there is music. Soli Deo Gloria, glory be to God alone. And even now, hate builds walls. Prejudice builds walls. Politics builds walls. And where will grace be that will tunnel through the wall? Knocking, pounding, knocking, pounding, bit by bit, piece by piece, risk your life, even so. Bring that wall down, down, down.
Folks are always building walls, and sometimes the church builds walls. In fact, more than sometimes. We've built a lot of walls in our time as a church, and I think this is a time when churches and all religious communities are in flux, and we are learning some new things. We are in a process of migration, a process of change, as Brian McLaren so beautifully says. I want to tell you about a place for me, which was a place I had to leave. In 1980, my wife and I fell in love, well, in 78, we fell in love with San Francisco. We came out to visit, and we saw a church in the inner city of San Francisco in the Haight-Ashbury area that moved us and thrilled us and excited us. It was the church we wanted to be a part of. And so we moved from New Jersey to San Francisco. We lived in the Haight-Ashbury, where all the hippie stuff was going on in the 60s and early 70s. The neighborhood was just beginning to regentrify, but there was a lot of hippie activity around. We had a cult in the neighborhood called the Foundation of Revelation that had a guru that had come from India and dispensed wisdom and walked around in beautiful robes. We had in the backyard of our house. We lived up on the second floor of an old Victorian. In the backyard, there was a tent where some of our neighbors smoked pot. We had one set of neighbors on uppers and one set of neighbors on downers. We had a young fellow who regularly would get up on the roof of the house about 11 o'clock at night and start doing a war chant to beat off the bad karma. So it was an exciting place to be. And we were right smack dab in the middle of it. And for about 30 years, we lived there. And then we moved to a couple of other places in San Francisco. Now we live in the suburbs. The city just became too difficult, really, in many ways. The city has become hopelessly expensive. And all the steps and all the hills and all that stuff just made it challenging. So we now live on on a one-level house in the East Bay. But I miss the city. I miss the noise and commotion and craziness and wonder of it all. So I want to sing this song because for me, the challenge has been to not be caught in the past, but to leap into the present and love it as much as I treasure the past. So, see what happens. I stand at the ocean. I look back at the land. I remember my childhood when I played in the sand. And heedless of danger, I ran to the sea to leap in the white caps and set my soul free. Now I'm older and cautious in so many ways, but I know there are beaches and white caps and journeys, but these are my best days. This is my choice. I want to leap into this brand new day, taste and to turn, to love and to learn what I could not know yesterday. No turning back, yesterday's gone. I'll relish this day, I'll treasure this dawn. What a romance, taking the chance of life. Childhood, when these streets were my own, I knew I was called here. This place held my heart. And now when I walk here, I feel like a stranger. It tears me apart. I will not come back here. No, that die is cast. I treasure the past. This is my choice. I want to leap into this brand new day, to taste and to turn, to love and to learn what I could not know yesterday. No turning back, yesterday's gone. I'll relish this day, I'll treasure this dawn. What a romance, taking the with a friend. I'll dance till I stumble, and I will get up again. I will not run for shelter when the pathway is unknown, for I am surrounded by friends and companions. I am not alone. This is my choice. I want to leave. The chance of life.
day. Run the race. I want to dream my life away. I want to love the night. Seize the day. Run the race. Don't want to dream my life away. I want to love the night. Seize the day. Run the race. Don't want to dream my life away. I want to love the night. Seize the day. Run the race. Don't want to dream my life away. This is my choice. I want to leap into this brand new day, to taste and to turn, to love and to learn what I could not know yesterday. No turning back, yesterday's gone. I'll relish this day, I'll treasure this dawn. What a romance, taking the chance of life.
You're never too old to make a readjustment. I believe that in my mind. I don't always know it with my emotions, but I'm getting there. And there are things about this life here. There are things about this house. There are things about the East Bay that are beautiful. And I never would have known them in San Francisco. So there, here we go. I think it's time for another story.
Okay.
Sonia, you have one for me, right?
Yes, I do. This one is from Woody Davis.
Who happens to be, I think, related to Linda Davis, right? I believe that's true.
I don't know.
Our last story was Linda. This is Woody. I believe that they
yes,
are.
Linda Davis. That's correct. Yeah,
I
Woody
that
Davis.
They are somehow connected.
Well, there you go.
There you go.
Okay. Woody says, in 1984, the bicentennial year of the United Methodist Church, I was chaplain for the North Carolina Conference Youth Choir Tour. The tour took us to Philadelphia, where we visited Lovely Lane Church, where the founding conference was held. I got to stand in the pulpit and read Psalm 100, where generations of Methodist forefathers had preached. We went downstairs into the Museum of Methodism, where I stood admiring the silver chalice that John Wesley had sent from England for the American preacher's use in celebrating communion. The museum curator said to me, "Would you like to see the real one?" I said, "This isn't it." He said, "Oh no, it is kept in the safe and only brought out once a year for annual conference communion." With that, he went to the safe, took the Wesley chalice out of its protective case, and handed it to me.
Oh my gosh.
And as I held that chalice, I truly experienced for the first time the reality that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses.
Hear a million voices singing in my ear as I hold this holy cup in my hand. It's only silver, it's only stuff, but how many hands have held this cup to make it holy, and how many mouths have drunk from this cup to be renewed to sing the holy song. I hear a million voices, maybe more, singing in my ear. They are free persons, they are slaves, they are rich, they are poor, they are criminals, they are prisoners,
they stand on their feet. They kneel on their knees. They sing the songs of deliverance. They sing the songs of salvation. They sing the songs of hope. They sing the songs of grace that goes beyond the walls we so carefully build. They are wall breakers. They are love makers. And as I hear those million voices, and as I hold in my hand this sacred cup, this prayer springs to my lips, and I sing it, oh, so quietly. Oh, when the saints marching in, and the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go.
So, jumping off that story about something that happened in church, I want to go back. A couple of weeks ago, we did a concert based on biblical stories, and we called it Ancient Stories for a Modern Age, and there was a story that I had intended to do but never got around to it. And this is something that happened in church. Now, I don't know about your church or your synagogue or your mosque or wherever it is, in fact, that you worship. But in most churches that I know of, at least, things are sort of cut and dry. We kind of know what the liturgy is going to be. We kind of know what the sermon's going to be. We kind of know how the service is going to go. Now, there are a few exceptions. I have been in a few churches, many of them among my African-American friends, where a lot of wonderful, unpredictable things happen, and somehow the Spirit finds freedom to blast out of the walls in which we want to make her live sometimes. But this is an event that was maybe unprecedented in the synagogue of which I'm going to sing. This young rabble-rousing rabbi had been invited to speak a word. Maybe he was going to preach the sermon or read from the sacred text. At any rate, he decides to do something which is not only controversial, but is going to get him in serious trouble. It begins with this woman who's telling her story. It happened in church. I love it.
Excitement fills the atmosphere as everyone has come to hear the carpenter turned preacher boy from Galilee. And as we rush to find our place, see the look on someone's face. When will it ever stop this way? They look at me. See how she is, they will kindly say. How did she come to be that way? Isn't it a shame and isn't it a pity? She'll never stand tall and she'll never look pretty. She's all bent over, she's all bent over, she's all bent over, and she can't stand straight. For 18 years I've heard cannot erase the sting, and every day I live just drives me further down. I've gone beyond all fantasy, all hoping for recovery, and now I know that I will be forever bound. See how she is, they will kindly say, how did you come to be that way? Isn't it a shame, and isn't it a pity? She'll never stand tall, and she'll never look pretty. She's all bent over, all bent over. She's all bent over, and she can't stand straight. Then all at once, I froze with fear. For the Galilean said, come here. And every eye was on me, and I wished to die. Stand up, I heard him say to me. And then he placed his hand on me, and all at once I stood to face him. Have I gone mad? Do my eyes deceive? It's been 18 years. I'm standing tall. How strange I feel. This must be real. So right there in that synagogue, I praise the God who brought me up again and gave to me this wonder man who came to me and took away my pain. He spoke to me with love and he destroyed the power of death, the strength of him. He made the crooked straight. Naturally, this little scene disturbed the Sabbath morn routine, and the fair synagogue's officials were a mite distressed. And in a voice both harsh and loud, the ruling elder stilled the crowd and tried to hide his anger, seeming unimpressed. A synagogue, in case you have forgotten it. Why do you behave in this frightfully disgusting way? This is the Sabbath day, in case you have forgotten it. See how the crowd plays your works on a holy day. This is a synagogue, in case you have forgotten it. See why do you behave in this frightfully disgusting way? This is a Sabbath day, in case you have forgotten it. See how the crowd plays your works on a holy day. Bent out of shape when I stood up straight. My songs of praises turned to fear. Some began to boo and jeer, and others followed up this leader's angry words. And Jesus stood to make reply. The fire was flashing in his eye, and when he spoke, the faintest breathing could be heard. Hypocrites, you loose your ox on the Sabbath day to let it go for water. Would you complain if I take away the chains that Satan has laid on this daughter of Abraham? And the amens came, they came from all around. And the angry red-faced rulers of the synagogue were put down. And I left that day with a brand new song. I left that day on wings to fly. My winter cold had turned to spring, for God had given hope. God had given hope. God had given hope that Sabbath day. So sisters, down the centuries, time to know you've been pressed down too long. And all who claim to follow Christ must call down power to end this ancient wrong. The God we love is mighty to destroy the power of death, strength of hate, to make the crooked straight, make the crooked straight. The God we serve is mighty to destroy the power of death, strength of hate.
Didn't distort the audio on that one because that was pretty loud. We need another story, I think, don't we?
Okay.
We have another.
This one is a quick one. I'm not going to get in the camera, but I just want to mention that Glenn Warner just said, "Hi, Ken. Zion National Park is a very sacred space for me."
Oh, yes, 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 yes.
Beautiful Zion, I'm climbing. climbing onward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
Several years ago, many years ago, I think it was maybe middle 70s, I wrote a song called If This Is Not a Place. And it's a song that several people throughout the years have commented on. I get letters pretty regularly saying If This Is Not a Place, or that song meant so much to me, because it endeavors to talk about real things like crying and weeping and asking questions. I've always dreamed that the church, or whatever religious community you happen to be a part of, would be a place like that. And so often it is not. It's a place where we meet each other and we say nice things to each other, and we are polite and we're kind and we're nice. Nice is a word that always comes to my lips when I go to church. It's very nice. And we rarely get down to the place where we can say, hey, how are you? Where do you hurt? Now, some churches are fortunate in that they have small groups where that can be done. But I feel like primarily the culture of religious institutions is one that does not encourage that kind of realness. And maybe part of the migration that we have to take in these times is to figure out how to be with people and ask real questions. To look in people's faces and be able to say, how are you really? So I offer this little song. At least in your home, let that be the culture. Let the culture of your home be a place where I can be real. I can talk about things that really matter to me, and you'll listen hard.
virtuous I am. No, I don't need another place to always be on top of things. Everybody knows that it's a sham. Oh, you know. I don't need another place. We're always wearing smiles, even when it's not the way I feel. I don't need another place. Same old platitudes, 'cause you and I both know that it's not real. So if this is not a place where my tears are understood,
is it story time again? Yes. I think it may be.
Okay. Here we go. This one is from Janet Rennick. And she said, as a child, our family vacations were always going from Daytona Beach, Florida, to the eastern shore of Maryland to see our extended family. As we got closer to our destination, we would all crane our necks to be the first one to see it. Somebody in the car would yell out, "I see the Bay Bridge," the Chesapeake Bay Bridge. And then we would know that in a very short time, we would be with aunts and uncles and cousins for a time of amazing memories. Maryland biscuits and crabs and corn and tomatoes. We were finally home for the next week or so.
I can't wait to see it. It happens every time. I can't wait to see it. It's like an old friend of mine. I dream about it on the days when we're gone. I dream of the moment when we spot it first and we know we can go on. Here we are in the car now. It's been a long, long drive. Everybody's weary. And as a kid, I think, will I ever survive? I can almost see it. Long now, I can feel it in my bones. There it is, my beloved bridge, and it means it won't be long now till we get back home. Maryland crab is waiting for us to come. Sometimes it's hard to see the end of the road, and you feel like you're locked in a night forevermore. Then something like a bridge comes into view. Maybe it's a phone call.
Maybe it's a text from someone you love and need to speak to. Maybe it's a letter in the mail. Maybe it's a check. Or maybe the doorbell rings and you wonder who is there, 'cause we're sheltering in place. And there comes someone beloved to you, whom you have not seen for a long, long time. And behind the mask and beneath the gloves, someone who's just waiting to say hello to you. You're gonna make it to home. You're gonna make it all the way. I'm the bridge, don't you see? There's nothing so much fun as doing these live events. Do we have another story?
Yes.
Oh, good.
Yes. This one is also from last week's comments. And this is from Ross Farney. And he said, at a little cottage by a little river, watching the tide come and go, reading a book in a rocking chair, watching the sunsets, the river calls. At high tide, the water calls to jump in under the sun or late at night under the moon. At low tide, the mud even calls to watch the shorebirds, to dig for clams to go fishing, or to escape in a kayak out into the bay. The river always calls.
Ooh. Great wide stream like the Mississippi, and all along that wide wide stream they'll be singing the blues forever. Tiny and narrow stream, hardly wide enough for your canoe. It may be a river hard to find.
buried back there in the woods, and you've got to walk a long, long way to find it. It may be a mountain stream, cold and clear. It may be a muddy river where you hardly dare go in. Rivers are magic. They've always been. Rivers are magic. The water's fine, so come on in. Rivers are magic since the very beginning of time.
For us to leave, is there one more story, yes. One more comment?
Okay, we've got Jan Michael Lawrence Haley said, my parents were resident managers of a church camp in Kansas. They were there for 30 years. That camp was the only home I knew until I left for college. It is my family's happy place. My father passed away April 4th, 2020. Exactly a week before he passed, my sisters and our husbands were able to take him to that camp for his final time. It was such a special, God-filled time for us as a family. Lots of memories and laughter that day.
Go back to renew old memories. I want to go back just to see what has become of me. I'm not the same person. I walked these trails back then. So much has happened, so many changes. I want to go back once again. I want to go back. Some things to clean away. There are some memories I need to purge from me today. There and stand in that place where I made so many stupid mistakes and knew so very much grace. Right now you can't go back there, 'cause we're all staying home. Back in your imagination, and the place will be glad to see you come.
Lace is our secret that we surely know. Thanks for going with me to all those many places. Thanks for going with me. It's been a pleasure. Just before we leave, let me say to you again what a privilege and honor it is for me to be with all of these wonderful friends. I know that you want this to continue. And supposing you do, would you be so good as to make a contribution to Interlude? Interlude is a nonprofit that helps us continue to do these Facebook live events. Interlude also sponsors retreats, conferences. We'll be trying to sponsor some virtual retreats for church musicians who are burned out and tired and don't quite know where to turn next. So Interlude is going to sponsor some retreats during the course of the year. You can go to interluderetreats.org and make your donation. Also, if you will go to our website, www.kenmedema.com, and download one song. I'm not even asking you to download a whole album. One song will help us immensely. I waited until the very end to say this. I didn't want to disturb all the good stories, but I really do need for you to know that we depend on your help. So I'm going to end with what has become for me a rather standard kind of greeting. Next week, it's going to be a little of this and a little of that. I'm going to relish your comments. I'll be singing some old songs, old for me, some great old hymns that I have treasured for a long time, some older pop songs that have become really a part of my repertoire, Funny Valentine, When I Fall in Love, some old hymns like Brethren, We Have Met to Worship, and some others. So, and then we'll see what happens. The week after that, it's going to be Make It Up As You Go Along. And I'm really going to depend on you to help me make up the songs as we go along. There'll be some prompts along the way. But so that's where we're going for the next 2 weeks. A little of this, a little of that next week, with some classics that I have loved for a long time, comments from you, and perhaps some new things. And then the week after that, Make It Up As You Go Along. So my standard departure is this. Let's use a different strain patch this time, huh? Good night. Stay safe.